silent mode. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. On behalf of IMC Chamber of Commerce and Industry, we welcome you to the half-yearly ordinary general meeting. I welcome Mr. Harsh Mariwala, our chief guest for this evening, IMC President Mr. Deepak Prem Narayan, our immediate past president, Mr. Dilip Piramal, our vice president, Dr. Lalit Kanodia, our director general, Mr. Arvind Pradhan, and our esteemed guest for this evening. May I kindly request our president, Mr. Deepak Prem Narayan, to deliver the welcome address and present the activities of IMC the past 6 months which IMC had organized.
Thank you. And good evening, ladies and gentlemen. To me personally, it gives immense joy to have Mr. Harsh Mariwala here as our chief guest for two reasons. One, on behalf of the chamber, it's 45 years ago that his late father's name is engraved here and he was our president, one. Secondly, Harsh's family's relationship with my family goes a long way. I'll never ever forget this, that his sister and I got married on the same day and our wedding receptions were in Bombay. His late mother, who was in New Era School with my father, came first to my reception, then went to her own daughter's reception. So that shows the value system of this family. As a man, Harsh, let me put it this way, that there are very few people like him. I'll just give you another instance, is that recently there was a wedding of a friend's daughter in Abu Dhabi. And so there were people saying that, you know, business class is 70,000. Somebody was saying it's first class is 1,04,000. And there you have Harsh Mariwala. He says, you guys are nuts. It's a 2.5 hour flight. Indigo is 18,000. Now here is a man who's worth $1 billion plus. But you see his thinking. And let me tell you, his thinking on the golf course is equally tough. I play golf with him and it's very difficult to get money out of him. When it comes to business, it's all known, but let me just share a few things with you. I go back, almost 37, 38 years ago, when at Masjid Bandar, you know, he started with his team on a mattress. I mean, that's where the family business, Bombay Oil, ran. And they had built a very good reputation for themselves. They had foresight, they were in Kerala, etc. Harsh, we will talk more when you, the topic that you're here for today, how you have professionalized the business and how you see family businesses being professionalized. But there are a few things that come to my mind. You know, the way, within about 15 years, his business was worth about 500-600 crores. And people wondered that you had Hindustan Lever, you had Procter & Gamble, and there is this young fellow, young, small, little speck. And why is this David fighting with these Goliaths? How will he ever survive? The easiest thing would have been is to sell. And you know, play golf regularly, maybe twice a day. But this is what he didn't do. And today, the stage came when he's gone global. He's in South Africa, other pockets of Africa, he's in Egypt. He's very successful, the number one Indian company in Bangladesh. If not, I think that's one of your most successful ventures overseas, Egypt, etc. Now, having achieved this, at the same time, look at the shareholder value he's created. And there have been businesses, and Indian businesses have been known, and I don't mind mincing my words as such, have been known to consider and look after their own interests first, the promoters, and then the shareholder. But here is a guy here is a friend, here is a person, here is an entrepreneur. For him, the shareholder has been of prime importance. Harsh, may I request all of us here to give him a standing ovation. Thank you very much, and I much appreciate this. Thank you. With this, may I, next time, should I? We also have a protocol where you have the last year's president, and we honor him by felicitating him and recognizing the good work that was done during his tenure. There is an album, and Dilip, I'm glad that you are here with us, and we are proud of what you did, and let us share some of the happenings of the last year. May I request Harsh to honor us by presenting this together.
We now request the President to please felicitate our Chief Guest, Mr. Harsh Mariwala, with a memento.
This is a part of the IMC protocol, and I'll save you the trouble of going through the entire thing. I'll go through it very rapidly. But the bottom line is that, thanks, Mr. Kim, you get on to the first one. It's just to share some of the happenings that have been there. We had the theme for the year is enhancing India's competitiveness, and our entire focus has been based on that. Because how do we address the competitiveness? The issues are that, firstly, you need to advocate policy. And that's the chamber's first job, first objective. And how do you advocate policy? You engage with the decision makers, engage with policy makers. You develop policy. You don't have to react. We basically contribute positively. So it's a question of working closely with the government of Maharashtra and the center. And so here, our focus has been in terms of what are the issues which affect this sector that we are involved in. The next slide, please. I think you missed out the slide, which has to do with the market access. Yeah. Okay, can you go back to that funnel? Yeah. It has to do with the, there are three issues that we tackled. It has to do with the reduction of cost of money. The biggest issue we have as SMEs is the cost of money. And you know, unfortunately, many of our members have to borrow money informally, and the interest costs go up to almost about 20% plus. So with international competition, where the interest costs are 2%, 3%, they are outpriced. And the next, so that has been a focus of the chamber. Next slide, please. Thank you. Next one, please. So what have we done here? Our interaction has been at every forum, whether it's the Chief Minister, whether it's the Governor of Maharashtra, whether it's the Prime Minister of India, on things like that, how do we enhance our competitiveness? Reduction of cost of capital, access to technology, access to markets, and skill development. So this is, these are the issues. With the Prime Minister too, if you notice there is a brochure out there which we gave our positioning on this. GST is another thing, an agenda item that we have pushed at different forums, whether it has to do at the Chief Minister's level, the Minister of Industry is here in Delhi with the Revenue Secretary and other policy makers. There has been, just not at this forum, even with the regulators, whether it's the ex-governor of the Reserve Bank, we said, we met him at that time and we, and the same issue was there because he also said that the SME, MSE sectors are those which need to be pushed because the cost of money doesn't come down. Unfortunately, what's been happening is that Reserve Bank has been taking rate cuts, but that has not been transmitted. And the banks haven't transmitted that, and that's hurting. So the importance of the growth of SMEs in the Indian economy, that has been also taken up with these regulators. With SEBI, our objective has been to develop a closer partnership, to work closer, so that we are there in the Capital Markets Committee and some of the other committees, so that we are well represented, because this is the financial capital of India. Here again with the state government, we worked on policy making very closely with the Minister and Secretary of Tourism to develop the medical tourism policy, where we've had a very interesting seminar, and now we have a task force which is going to be working closely with the government to see that we enhance tourism, particularly medical tourism, in the state of Maharashtra. With the Municipal Commissioner of Mumbai, we partnered NASCOM. With NASCOM, what we are doing is that right now we are launching a program for digital financial literacy. And this is through the municipal, they've got a very strong control room for reaching out to schools and colleges and out of Worli. So the idea is to educate people in slums, in schools, colleges, about different digital processes. Simplistic thing. With the Mumbai police, again, it's just not a question of meeting the police commissioner. And he's an important element in our city here. But developing a platform where together we've got certificates. Now going to be, there's a panel set up to recognize police force who have worked meritoriously. On the skill side, the secretary, skill development for the state, there has been close interaction. As a result, four people from your chamber are now in the Maharashtra government's skill committee. We've taken up on the international side, we were in Portugal, we had a strong delegation of 22 people. Horaces is a breakaway of the World Economic Forum, and we have co-partnered them for the future. There was an MOU also which was signed. This is with the Deputy Mayor of Castries, they want Mumbai to become a sister city. That is the Union Minister of State for External Affairs. He also actively participated in the seminar. The next one, please. We had a member who was led, our Minister of Industries was with us, and he led the delegation on behalf of IMC. This is at Horaces. Again, on an international platform, there is a CEO's forum in South Africa with the Prime Minister. Ali Godrej is the chair of the forum from India, and your president is the co-chair. So we led a delegation there, and it had to do with the Prime Minister's delegation. The next one, please. This is a very important slide for us. And as a chamber, you know, Ram Gandhi is very modest. When we told him, congratulations, you have come on, and you're now on this particular general body of the ICC, WCF, he said, it's the power of the chamber. And of course, he says, a lot goes to Mr. M.K. Sanghi for the effort he put in, and our Director General, who was in Barcelona and actively worked on this also. I'll just go back and say that Mr. Sanghi himself is the past president of the Executive Committee and is a member of the ICC, WCF, and they have 12,000 chambers which are associated. So that is the positioning that we have today. So it's been a very proud moment for us. MK, congratulations and thank you. Next one, Lucy, thank you. I'll just cover some of the key conclaves that have been organized. We were in Delhi on Saturday, and the photograph is not very clear, but that is Jaswant Sinha there. On my left is the mayor of, ex-mayor of Barcelona, and the chairman of the Infrastructure Committee, Harishankaran, is on his left. Then you have Lalit Kanodia and RDG Anurag Pradhan. This was attended by almost 170 people. Yeah. And my apologies, about 100, yeah, thereabouts. Most of them paid delegates. You had five speakers from different countries. The Lord Mayor, ex-Lord Mayor of Adelaide. You had the person who was the CEO for the London City. And you had Rajiv Gauba, our Secretary of Urban Development. And you had the Joint Secretary from external, from the DEA. So we had very active government partners. The head of Cisco was there, the head of Panasonic, etc. And they also sponsored the event. Can I go to the next one, please? Just stay here, but I'd like to go on the previous slide and just mention that it's very interesting that we have started receiving letters from people who participated there that it was a fantastic experience and when are you having the next one. This wasn't a flash in the pan, having this infrastructure conference in Delhi. It had a method in its madness. Two reasons. One is that we have a series of infrastructure conclaves. I'll come to the one that we had in railways in September. And also we wanted to establish a foot in Delhi, because Delhi is important for policy and we need to be there. As a result of this, we now had this recognition. So I also would like to mention the Asia head of the Canadian Pension Fund from Quebec was there. She was one of the speakers too. Member of the, one of the ministers who was in charge of planning for Andhra Pradesh, he was there. So this is, yes, there were four countries, technology, innovative financing, this was discussed. The conference started at 9:15 in the morning and got over at 6 o'clock in the evening, Lalit? Yeah, thereabouts. And most of the delegates were there. This was another infrastructure conference that we had, a $1 trillion opportunity. This was held in Bombay, and Suresh Prabhu, there was Deepak Parekh there, of course, and we recognized and awarded the CEO of Siemens and the CEO of Reliance Infra for the projects that they had done, which have brought recognition to the city. The, but also I must say here that in both these conferences, McKinsey was our knowledge partner, and we've had the exactly what we want to do is development of policy and submit this to the government, and that's what we have done. The next slide, please. We had another program which was in partnership with the UN, IMC and UN. When I say IMC, this was an initiative that we have taken intentionally that we work closely with the Ladies' Wing. So this was a program by IMC Main Chamber and the Ladies' Wing. This was held on the 6th of December. You have in the center the number two of the UN. She heads the entire ladies program and she was ex-deputy president South Africa. That's how we got to know her earlier, 20 years ago. There was an MOU which was signed, and this MOU is specifically got to do with gender equality. Women, if brought into the mainstream in India, can contribute almost $3 trillion to our economy in the next 7 years. They work in homes, they're not compensated adequately. They look after the family, they look after labor, they look after finance, they look after cooking, they look after washing. There's no compensation. If they were to be brought into the mainstream, what it would do to my country's economy. So this was, she was the chief guest. We had Katrina Kaif, who was there as one of the guest of honors. That's a session where Chanda Kochar is there and which was being moderated. Very good panelists, Sunil Munjal and Mrs. Sahani, Hindu Sahani. Next one, please. This was Arnab Goswami moderating the session, which again, we had fantastic speakers. In the next one, you have Lalitha Kumaramangalam. She is the chairperson of the National Women's Council. If I've said that correctly, but I think I've given the message. Next one, please. Iconic monuments in Mumbai were lit in orange. That's the VG station on top. That's the Gateway of India. But what's important is that this isn't the program which was only peculiar to Bombay. She's done that in 70 countries, and she concluded that in India. So this was the last stop and an important stop. What I'm wearing here today is he for she. This is her program globally. This is another program that was done by the ladies' wing and the gents' wing, I mean the main chamber together, a part of our partnership. We had Amitabh Kant here, we had, and I must say, Amitabh is Amitabh. And he spoke about smart cities. The essence of a smart city is not technology. It has got to do with the heart. And that's what Amir Khushru, a poet of the 13th century, said about Delhi. He was half Turkish, half Persian, but he said that Delhi had a heart, and he says it's the most hospitable city in the world. So we want to make cities which are smart, but smart in terms where children can play, blossom, fly. Can we go to the next one, please? I'm sorry, I promise you I won't take more than another 3-4 minutes. This was engaging with different political parties. We had Congress, we had BJP, you had TMC, and you had the JDU, Pawan Verma, Dinesh Trivedi, Siddharth Singh, Milind Deora, and Sanjay Pugalia was the moderator. The very interesting discussion. It ultimately got down to working together to see how the country prospers. Next thing, please. This is our medical tourism conference, which again was very successful, the first that we did. So it's a platform. What we are doing is we're setting up platforms for future, which become in terms of policy, participation with the government, plus this creates revenue for our state. And this is a task force which is working closely with the secretary as well as the minister. A few other conferences and events. There's the MOS from the POMO, TMO. And he was here precisely to talk about Northeast, which is also one of his portfolios, other than atomic energy and space. He wants Maharashtra to participate in skill development because and participate in terms of also industries there. So we had a small crowd, but INFS, etc., have got projects which are there, which had issues, and now he's personally addressing that. So as a chamber, we've been able to assist in terms of issues. The next one, please. They proposed, of course, they want to have a desk, and you sent a proposal to them, a desk at IMC to promote skill development in our state for Northeast citizens, as well as to promote tourism. This was a speed dating a conclave that we had where we get buyers, people who want money, and people, private equity firms. Dushan Dave had organized this. This is Siddharth Desai. Yeah, it's a subject dear to his heart also. And we've got one happening with Dushan also. Next one, please. This is we had the Kilachan Memorial Lecture. Dr. Romila Thapar spoke, and mind you, she had everybody spellbound because of her knowledge and because of her position in terms of government policies currently. We also had a conclave on contribution of HR. Sandeep Puri and his group worked very hard on this, and we had almost 100 plus paid delegates. Next one, please. I'm sorry, I'm not going to be showing everyone, but this has got to do with the financial side of it. You've got Nishi Singh, where we were specifically addressing the voluntary disclosure scheme which was on, and to understand issues around that. Well attended. Justice Ashwar's committee, where Pradeep Shah, one of our board members, is on that committee, and they heard us very carefully through the day. These are ERTF initiatives. Discussion on tariff crops, unlocking of gold's potential, and what board can do as far as if it's brought into the liquid form, play in the market. Next one. Now, ADR center is a very important center for us. It is, and you know, disputes. Why should they go to Singapore for settlement? We've got all the facilities here, and we've got a world-class center with world-class facilities, and we want to promote that. And also with that, we've got almost world-class Gujarati food and snacks that we offer here also. So that's another attraction. And what I'd like to urge you all today is to make sure there are more issues for mediation so that our center benefits. This is a part of the program that was there. Darius Kambata, one of our senior counsels. This was on a Saturday. The next one is a proxy advisory firms. We had that done by Bhavna Doshi, initiated that. Very well attended by CEOs of various companies, CFO, Vedanta, etc. Next one, please. So this is also the conflict resolution. We've had the previous Chief Justice, current Chief Justice. Next, the whole purpose being is to promote the ADR Center. And on the next one, we have 200 plus associations which we are affiliated to. And they bring a lot of value. You got the Paint Association, which has got about 2,000 members. Manoj Patodia's association, which he chairs, also has got a few hundred members. You got the Stainless Steel Merchants Association. They have about 1,500 members. Bombay Industries Association, about 1,200 members today. So we have interacted very closely with them. We've gone for their functions, and the engagement has started. So as a result of which, today, I'm conscious that my friend, Mr. Jain of Navi Mumbai, has brought 10 people in a minivan, and he's promised me that he's not going to build a chamber for this. Next one, please. There have been several international delegations. Some of them I'd like to mention. Our Brazilian Consul General made a very special effort, and she's here today. Thank you. She brought one of her cabinet ministers also here. He was ambassador in India earlier. We've had the U.S. Consul General, we've had the Undersecretary of the from Argentina. I won't take up your time on this. If you can, we've had the ambassador from Greece, etc. But important thing is that IMC continues to be recognized, although you had FICCI and CII at the center. But we have been pushing hard to get engagement happening. Next one. This is the Young Leaders Forum, which has got to do with under Viren Merchant. They're a young dynamic group. And we've had Ashok Bajpai, who was here on digitalization and the role that it plays in security, cybercrime, etc. Very interesting topic. And our chief secretary was here. And these youngsters made sure that he didn't go until he promised that some of the things were sorted out. They set deadlines, which is good. Thanks, Viren. Next one, please. Navi Mumbai. You know, it's difficult to keep pace with the Navi Mumbai group, I tell you. They are so active, they are so energetic, and there is so much happening there. They also opened a new conference center, and we had the pleasure of inaugurating that. So your chamber has a beautiful facility in Navi Mumbai, and we can make use of that. Thank you, Jim. RK. Next one, please. Last but not the least, if those of you paid attention, even but thank you very much for your patience.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Moving forward, we will now begin with our session on professionalizing a family-run managed business, and which would be moderated by Mr. Deepak Prem Narayan, our President, IMC. I request all the other dignitaries on the dais to kindly take their seats on the front row. Now I request Mr. Viren Merchant, Chairman Young Leaders Forum, to kindly introduce the chief guest, Mr. Harsh Mariwala.
Good evening, everyone. It's my honor and privilege to have this opportunity to introduce a legend. Mr. Harsh Mariwala is the chairman of Marico Ltd. He is the chairman and managing director of Kaya Ltd. Over the past three decades, Mr. Mariwala has transformed a traditional commodities and services company, commodities-driven business, into a leading consumer products and services company in the beauty and wellness space. Mr. Mariwala's entrepreneurial drive and passion for innovation enthused him to establish the Marico Innovation Foundation in 2003. The foundation acts as a catalyst to fuel innovation in India. Mr. Mariwala started Ascent in 2012, a non-profit venture designed as a unique and powerful peer-to-peer platform for ambitious entrepreneurs who have already embarked on their journey and are raring to go. He was the president of FIKI in 2011. It's a proud moment for the YLF team to have him and guide us through forward. Thank you, sir.
Harsh has had two introductions already, and you all know about him a lot. Harsh, you know, tell me, you came straight out of college and got into business. And you were in a business which there were lots of family members and, you know, you all worked together. What spurred you to change it into a corporate process-oriented institution?
Oh yes, I was the first person from the next generation to join the family. My father being the eldest, he was the chairman, and he had three brothers, so three of my uncles were running the show. But it was completely family managed. When I say family managed, there are two, three extremes. One is the family is involved in day-to-day decision making. All the decisions are taken by the family. And the family has some other confidants, some other relatives, some other friends who help the family to perform. So when I finished my graduation from Bombay, I wanted to study further. I wanted to do my MBA. I was not that bright enough to get into IIM or Bajaj. And I told my father I wanted to go abroad. So my father put his foot down, saying nothing, you're not looking abroad because you'll never come back. Or you'll come back married to somebody else whom you would not want me to do. So I joined the family organization, and those days, you know, your kids were very, very different compared to today's kids, you know. If you tell your children today, hey, you're not going, they will rebel and go. So at a very young age, I joined the family organization. And there was nobody who trained me, and my father said that, okay, now you join and see whatever you want to do. So that's how I started exploring. I visited, we had three different businesses. And I went to factories, and I went to the markets and met customers. And in that exploration, because there was nobody to teach me, no training program or nobody to, I was just left alone. I started reading a lot. And that's how I said that, okay, this business is family managed today, is family run. But I think there is a huge potential to improve. And we can only expand, grow, if we professionalize this business, if we recruit the right quality talent. Because I saw that that was the only way to move forward. And I think ultimately, behind professionalizing or behind changing the culture of the organization, the key reason was that I wanted growth to happen. And a growth which is sustainable and profitable. You don't want to see a situation where one year you grow and next year you fall down. So our corporate performance when I joined was not bad, but not great. It was very erratic.
Can I just interrupt you?
Yes.
Yeah. You said that you wanted to professionalize, but you know, when you had a business which was just 60 lakhs and you turn over, why should a student from IIM Ahmedabad join you? Or why should not I am Ahmedabad, why should young professionals join you?
No, when you are that small, you will never be able to recruit somebody from IIM Ahmedabad.
No, but
when I say professionalize, I mean somebody who earns, who is joining you on merits. He need not be an MBA, it could be just a graduate, but he joins you because he joins you on merit, and that is the only source of income. So when I started, when we were very small, we had to recruit some people who were working at a very low level, leavers, not highly professional, not highly qualified. And I think that helped, because there's no way if I had taken somebody high up, we could afford the costs, nor they would have been effective, because they would want a much larger scale. So looking back, I think that was the right decision to recruit people at lower levels, those who had some experience, and not highly qualified.
Good, well, thanks, go ahead. But you know, interestingly, that some of them have become CEOs of very large companies, including some Tata companies today. One Tata company at least.
So that happened much later. You know, I'm talking of initial phases when you start, and then you start growing. Every time there is a attrition in your team, you go on improving the quality of talent. And that's one thing I've always done. Whenever there is a vacancy, I see that what was the earlier guy doing, can we hire a person at a much higher salary who's better than that earlier person? And over a period of time, multiple times, talent has changed because of attrition. And every time there is an opportunity to change talent, you go on upgrading standards. So the MBA program started much later. We started in 1990 when Marico was formed. And that time we started taking 15, 20 management graduates. Today we are completely family-owned, professionally managed, where we have something like 150, 200 MBAs working for us. But what I'm trying to say is that stage when we were very small, we couldn't have afforded to do that. Once we grew in size of 100 crores, 200 crores, turnover, then you have to take very good talent, you know. And not because that person is MBA, but selection for MBA is such that because of good selection process of MBA, you get good quality talent. And they are far more, shall I say, they have a much more holistic viewpoint in terms of handling things, understanding the business.
How do you see yourself in terms of, let's say you've got inheritance tax coming in, estate duty coming in, possibly, if not in the next year or 2 or 3 years, how would you take care of that as a family business, which you own a large share today?
See, I think there are two aspects to succession planning. More important than the taxation part is what will happen to the business if something happens to you. I think to me that's far more important than the tax part. So what I have done is that I'm the only family member in the business. And I shared my responsibilities as managing director about 2.5 years back. So I'm just a chairman, and I don't spend more than 25-30% of my time on the company. So at one level, I have taken a successor who is managing the company on a full-time basis. And the other hand, I have created a very effective board of directors. So the board will play a very, very important role if something happened to me, to ensure that whoever is managing the company is the right person, as and when if there is a vacancy at that level, how do we fill that vacancy up? And every founder brings something to the table. It's very important to identify what is that value which the founder has brought to the table, what is known as founder's mentality. So what I've done is I've identified two things which I thought I brought to the table. So these are things like the values in the culture of the organization. I spent a lot of time in building a culture of the organization. It's very difficult. I think somebody's waiting now. It's very difficult to build a culture in the organization. It's easy to work on a strategy, but building a culture is a 3 to 5 year exercise. And it's very important that organizations understand what culture building is. I've seen many organizations where your values based on the reception of the company, and when you ask people down the line, is this something which exists in the organization? The answer is people start becoming cynical. you don't want to be in a situation where your values which are not practiced. And it's very important that the top management set the right example. So when I finalized our values journey, I wrote it down myself. I wrote it some like 20, 30 random pages. When Marico took over the consumer products business of mobile industries in 1990. And I shared that with my team at that time. We discussed those values for almost 8-10 full days. At the end of those deliberations, we had a value document which was far better structured, which had more value add because everybody else also added value. And we said, what next? Because finalizing value is very easy, but how do you build a culture is far more difficult. So we went to all our factory locations, all our sales locations, and talked to people what these values are, why are they important, and they can use these values as an empowering way to operate. So after sharing all that, I think the key challenge for organization is to reinforce values on a perpetual basis. So I'll give you a few examples what some of our values are. One of our values is openness. We want people to talk to each other and not behind people's backs. So we said that how can we reinforce openness within the organization? We were moving into a new office at that time, so the brief given to the interior was it should reflect openness. People should be able to see everybody else. We have an open house at all our locations, once a year. All our factories, all workmen, all our sales locations, all our international locations, and people are encouraged to ask any awkward questions to the management. It could be relating to their salary, it could be relating to a strategy. But again, you are taking a step which reinforces openness. We also send all our senior managers to a training program which promotes openness. So when you reinforce openness from different angles, you create an open culture. One more example of trust. We believe a lot in trust. So we said that how does an organization give an indication to all our members that we trust you? So way back in 1990, we did expense statements where you need to get authorization from your bosses. We said that we'll have a clear policy. If you spend something on behalf of the company, you do self-authorization. You don't need to go to your boss. We will do some random surveys, audits. If somebody is misusing, that person will be asked to go. We did away with muster in the organization because we said that we trust our members. We did away with something like a sick leave because we said that if you're sick, you're sick. We trust you, you know. So you take sick leave whenever you are sick and don't try and get entitlement of 10 days sick leave which gets added to your whatever privilege leave. So steps like that, each person maintains their own leave records. So I think a lot of steps the organization took to give a signal that we are trusting. And I think we've won back that trust from our members. We want to be an innovative organization. So for being an innovative organization, values like openness was important. We believe that risk taking is very important. So we want people to take risks. But if I punish failures, risk-taking will lead to failures because every time you're not going to succeed. So the direction is clearly if somebody takes risks and fails, do not punish that person because the moment you punish a person, that risk-taking will stop completely from the organization. So how do you create a culture of innovation, empowerment, a culture where people enjoy working is something we've done over a period of time. And I think that to me is very, very important in terms of attracting talent, retaining talent. People enjoy working in an organization where there is very little politics, where you can go and talk to your superior, where you can actually dialogue directly with anybody else cross-functionally. You don't need to go and take permission, can I talk to somebody else in some other function. I think that has helped a lot in terms of our journey. And I think many organizations I've seen are not paying that much attention to culture building, which to me is very, very crucial. I think, as I said, culture building takes 3 to 5 years. The bigger challenge comes in when over a period of time some people leave and new people come in. So we spend extra efforts in ensuring that the new people who are coming into the organization, they spend 1 to 1.5 days in terms of understanding why culture building is important, what is our culture in the organization. Even when you make acquisitions, we made something like 10-12 acquisitions. I think over a period of time, we have to change the culture in the acquired organization. But that may take some time. It may take 3 to 5 years. So it needs a lot of effort, cultural building, but I think the payoff is huge. And because it is impossible to copy, you can copy somebody else's technology. But culture is so fuzzy that it's very, very difficult to copy. So that was my answer. I don't think one should get worried about the estate duty and all that. To me, that's a taxman's thing. I mean, everybody does that. I don't want to get into it. I don't think I can add value in
how
tax planning I have done and what kind of mechanism I've used to ensure that estate duty doesn't get us.
No, you're correct. I put it wrongly. What I meant was, let's say, that today, with this tax coming in, what could happen is the shares that you own, they go to your son, would be taxed at the estate duty rate. So there is a question of whether your trusts are being formed. When you form a trust, that can be a perpetual trust or that can be a one-generation trust. So in that context, I was saying that you are already heading in that direction. You created a board to protect. You created a structure to protect, create succession. So my question was giving you the opportunity to address from the longevity of the...
I think all I can say is we've taken steps to ensure that the longevity from the taxation side, as well as in terms of continuity, even if I'm not there, there is a certain shareholder lock-in, so the organization will continue. And we have taken steps to ensure that even the estate duty comes with it, doesn't get us. I don't want to get into specific, because there are enough tax experts here who can advise much better than me.
Tell us what other things that in your journey, whether it is a question of buying a company of weavers, I think you bought Nihar, or whether it was what gave you as a David without education, without M&A experience, and how did you go about this?
So in 1996, Marico went public, and we went public. And post that, Hindustan Lever at that time acquired Tata Oil Mills, and they were doing very, very well. They had given a lot of, they had taken a lot of market share from Colgate in their oral care category through their brands Pepsodent and Signal, and they had given a big fight to Colgate. So they were riding very, very high in terms of the overall image they had created at that time. And I must say that at that time, that was the peak in terms of how they were performing as an organization, much better than what Lever is performing today, in my opinion. So there was a big, so when they acquired Tata Oil Mills, they had acquired, in that process, they got inherited a brand in coconut oil, which was competing against us. They also bought one more brand from the market, Coco Care. And so they had two brands which would compete against us, and we had just gone public, and they had identified that this is one area where they can grab a lot of market share from Marico. So because of that, they acquired two brands, and they went public in their analyst meets saying that if we have given such a fight to Colgate, Marico was very weak compared to Colgate, and we were not as strong as a brand as Colgate is. And we will just either finish them or we'll take them over. So there was a lot of fear in the company. There were a lot of approaches made to me, not once, but 10 times from different groups. And when nothing worked out, I got a phone call from the chairman of Hindustan Lever, and I had never met him. And he called me up in the evening one day and said, at that time, you have a mobile, I think. So he said, Mr. Mariwala, I understand, you know, you're not responding to my requests of selling off, but I thought I'll talk to you personally. I still suggest you reconsider it, because if you don't do it, you may just lose everything. But if you sell out, all your future generation will be taken care of financially. So I was hell-bent, I don't know why, but I was obstinate, I was stubborn, and I said, nothing doing. Mr. Dhari said, I will not sell out. We will fight in the marketplace. So post that, we took steps on four different fronts, because there was a lot of fear. Our share prices fell down because the capital markets realized that we will suffer a lot in taking on levers. So our share prices fell down dramatically. And they knew that I was not going to sell out. Our distribution was weak compared to levers in rural areas, so we took a lot of steps in terms of going rural and appointing distributors in rural areas. We improved the quality of the product, but the most important thing which we needed to tackle was the morale of the field force, because there was a lot of fear amongst our own field force, amongst our distributors' field force, whether we can take on a giant like levers. They will spend a lot of money in advertising. Their distribution is far, far superior than ours. And how come we have decided to take them on? So we had to actually deal with motivation, and we called all our field force, including distributors' field force. And we created a war room scenario where you actually had to enter that conference room through a tunnel. And we showed them a film, which I have here if you want to see it. But the whole objective was to motivate that we'll take them on. For us, Parachute was the resource generating engine. It was forming substantial part of our turnover. For them, it was one amongst many brands. And we said that what we had steps we had taken in the area of quality, steps we had taken in the area of advertising, we showed them all that. So I think that really helped. We also gave them a lot of ammunition in terms of taking them on, empowered, hotlines, things like that. And Levers launched the product, not once, but they launched it 2-3 times. They got some market share. They got 10-12% market share, but not at all costs. Their market share was gained at the cost of some other weaker players. At some stage, after 4-5 years, the whole lever journey started changing, because it started getting integrated more and more with human levers. So at that time, coconut oil as a portfolio never existed in Unilever category of products. So somewhere along the line, because they were not able to succeed, because they were not able to, it was not getting into the Unilever portfolio, they started losing interest, and their market share started falling from 12% to almost 8%. And at that time, the leadership changed in Hindustan Lever, and I used to play golf with some of the managing director of Hindustan Lever at that time, and I went on telling him that, you know, why are you continuing this? Because the brand is suffering, you're not paying attention. So why don't you sell it off? You get some value out of this brand. And somewhere in those conversations, the penny dropped, and I thought they would just sell it to us. Unfortunately, they decided to put the brand on the block. So they decided to have an open auction, wherein we were asked to quote, and there were 5 Indian players who participated. Dabur, Godrej, us, Imami, and I think Vipro or one more player, I don't remember. And for us, it was very important to acquire the brand, because their brand was doing much better in the East, and we were relatively weak in the East. If we bought their brand, we had 8% market share, and we at that time had about 46% market share, we would consolidate our market share. If the brand had gone to some other player, it would have a new competitor, so we would have to fight that. So from all angles, it made sense for us to get that brand. We knew that business, and we were absolutely certain that we'd be able to shave off a lot of costs because of better sourcing. And the fact that we were involved in this business for a long period of time. So the question came, okay, how much to quote? We did our valuation. And normally, as businessmen, you try to then guess, you know, what price you will quote, what price your competitor will quote, and then try and optimize the price. And I still remember a few days before we had to give a quote, we had a board of directors meeting. Our valuation came to about 200, and I'm talking 2006. Our valuation, as per our calculation, maximum we could pay was about 216 crores. But we were pitching to the board, can we go 170, 180? We can save those 30, 40 crores easily, because I don't think others will quote. But I must say the board gave a direction saying that it is so strategic for you. calculation, you have to go all the way, because if you lose that deal, then you will, you should never regret. So we went all the way. We quoted 216, and Lee was also was pleasantly surprised, because they never expected to get this kind of deal. Others quoted in the range of 150, 170, 150, 160. So we could have got the deal to 170. But I think to me the key learning was that when it is so strategic, you have to bother, you cannot afford to take risk. You cannot afford to optimize. You know, because if we had lost the deal, then I would have regretted all my life. So we acquired that brand in the year 2006 from them. And looking back, it has been the best acquisition for us. Today, we must be making a profit of more than 200 crores in that time. So it has been a huge value addition to us. Apart from that, we have not had, we reduced one competitor also in the marketplace. But I think that was the news story.
Does that guy from Lever talk to you now?
Yeah.
Just putting your legs in. That apart. So, but tell me, in Egypt also, when you had your acquisition, didn't you follow the same philosophy?
So Egypt, we acquired two brands in hair care. We have hair gels and hair creams. And one of the brands, the first brand we acquired, had a lot of issues to do with governance. You know, they were selling a lot of their products in cash. So it was very clear from day one, we will not. And in that journey of converting from cash to official, I think we lost out quite a lot in the first year, because we underestimated the impact of not selling in cash. But I think it's okay, you know, you go through that learning curve. But Egypt has had its own share of problems, you know, because of the Egyptian revolution a few years back, and now the Egyptian currency has fallen by 100%, 50%. So all of a sudden our sales are just halved in the last 1 year. So I think the international acquisition, the key learning is that it is far more, I would say, difficult to imagine what's going to happen in international markets. And we tend to get excited about international acquisition, but the key direction, at least we are given, is that we should provide for some uncertainties, because it's very difficult sitting here to know what is happening in Egypt. And sometimes something happens which even the people sitting there, they would not know that this is going to happen. So it's very important that international acquisition, you keep a little larger buffer in terms of what can go wrong.
Harsh, having played golf and been with you as a friend, close friends for years now, I am sure that I can come up with a lot of things to keep asking you, and you can keep everybody engaged here for a long time. But I'm sure there are people in the audience who would love to ask some questions. Can I?
Is that okay with you?
Maybe, yes.
Excuse me. Did you see the film which you mentioned? Sorry. You don't see the film. Motivated me. Thanks, SK. Well, you start with the question. You heard that my secretary said, you know, just there are two films. You can play. One is an ad film, which is also worth seeing, and another is a film.
I made it a point to be here. I was looking forward to hear from you. You've been one of the very outstanding personal business, and I have seen it very closely how things have been turned on in such a positive manner. I have only two small questions. When we see multinational companies all over the world, majority time we hear that the succession of the shareholding is a particular group, their daughter, their son, much as there is a professional group of directors are working. In a case which is a truly Indian company, and I give it to understand that the children are no longer directly involved with your business, how you are going to take this issue further? And number two, how do you make sure that the so-called board of directors will see that their interest continues to be in the company as alive as before, especially after the recent Tata episode has shaken us off?
So I think I have See, normally there are conflicts when you're a promoter and you are also managing the company. Does the promoter interest come first or does the company's interest come first? And I've always said that whenever there are conflicts, I should wear the company first, because the company is not solely owned by me. It's a public company, I have an ownership, I have one of my uncles as a co-promoter, and I have almost about 40% of